social statistics. In previous lesson, we discussed about data processing and tabulation. To comprehend data and draw conclusions, we need to analyze data using statistical tools. The aim of this lesson is to make you understand the use of statistical methods in data analysis. This lesson is divided into two parts, A and B. In part A, we will discuss about social statistics, functions of statistics, the place of statistics in social research, limitation of statistics, proportion, percentage, ratio, and arithmetic mean. In arithmetic mean, calculating the mean from ungrouped data and shortcut method. In part B, we will learn about calculation of arithmetic mean from group data, calculating the median and mode. Social statistics. Knowledge of statistics helps social worker in two ways. First, the knowledge allows the social worker to be able to analyze the data as per his research objectives and draw inferences, which in turn enable him to expand and improve not only the knowledge base of his profession, but it also enables him to make his practice effective. Second, as a consumer of research, it enables him to understand the analysis of data, appreciate the statistical procedures used in research reports. Statistics, a branch of applied mathematics, is regarded as mathematics applied to observational data. Consequently, everything dealing with the collection, processing, analysis, and interpretation of numerical data belong to the domain of statistics. A second meaning of the term statistics refers to the statistical principles and methods implied in collection, processing, analyzing, and interpretation of any kind of data. In this sense, it is a branch of applied mathematics and helps us to know the complex social phenomena better and lend precision to our ideas. It is this field of mathematics which is the subject matter of this lesson. Functions of statistics. Statistics has two broad functions. The first of these functions is description, the summarizing of the information in a such a manner as to make it more usable. The second function is induction, which involves either making generalization about some population on the basis of sample drawn from this population, formulating general laws on the basis of repeated observations. The two functions of a statistical method can be easily understood by following example. If it is desired to study the problem of labor unrest in a particular area, the first thing that is to be done is to analyze the various causes of labor unrest and to study the impact of each one of these causes on the various categories of labor, namely male workers and female workers, or skilled labor and unskilled labor. This kind of analysis will give us an insight into the problem, and we will be able to know from such analysis many things. The place of statistics in social research. Knowledge of basic statistical concepts and techniques is necessary for an intelligent understanding of generality of life. There are essentially two reasons why social workers using statistics and the need to study statistics have grown enormously in the field of social science. One reason is that the huge amount of data collected by researcher need simplification so as to render them capable of being commonly understood without much difficulty. The second and even more important reason is the increasingly quantitative approach currently being employed in social research. Limitations of statistics. One obvious limitations of statistics is that it is readily applicable to problems that are amenable to quantitative expression and treatment. Although qualitative attributes may sometimes be subjected to statistical analysis, these of necessity have to be translated into quantitative indices by recourse to the operational definitions. But then, much would depend on the validity of the operational assumptions. Unfortunately, this is a pit many researchers fall into, that is, qualitative data are often operationalized as a numerical values without deeper concern regarding their validity, in which case it is rather the poor data that stands to be blamed and not statistics. In as much as many problems of concern to social scientists are influenced greatly by subjective factors unamenable to mathematical treatment, the statistical approach hardly helps to get a sound understanding of the problem. It is understandable that the statistical laws are applicable to average of aggregates. These pathetically ignore the individual intricacies of solitary units. Such neglect may in certain investigation lead to merely superficial findings. The social human sciences typically have a keen concern for the unique and the idiosyncratic aspects. Additionally, there is a likelihood that statistics may be misused so much so that the researcher may be in a position to twist them to suit his found conclusions or hypothesis. This is also equally applicable to the very sensitive tool that the statistical methods are. They are liable to be misused easily. This is where great caution needs to be exercised in using them. As we shall have an occasion to see later, the validity of certain statistical methods depends on the nature of data, the levels of measurement, the knowledge of the pertinent aspects, and lastly, the assumptions made vis-a-vis the sample from which the data are collected. What is most important for us as a potential user of statistical methods, therefore, is to bear in mind that statistics has powerful muscles that can only serve and not direct. Much would depend on the use we want to put it to and whether the situation justifies it. What is given out by statistical computation may not be the final truth, since it is basically on approximation of typicality and by nature probabilistic. It is left largely to our interpretive skills to bring out the message of truth underlining the statistical inferences and propositions, proportions, percentages, and ratios. In order to make the data easily understandable and fit for analysis and interpretation, the size of the data is considerably reduced and a large number of figures are condensed. But even after these basic arithmetic operations, data might be fairly large and unwieldy, and it may not be easy to draw inferences. However, this difficulty is removed by measures like proportion, percentages, and ratios. Proportions. The proportion of cases in any given category are defined as the number in the category divided by the total number of cases. In calculation of proportion, it is presumed that the method of classification has been such that categories are mutually exhaustive and exclusive. That is, any given individual has been placed in one and only one category. To illustrate, let us take a nominal scale consisting of four categories with N1, N2, N3 and N4 cases respectively. Let the total number of cases be N. Therefore, proportion of individuals in the first, second, third and fourth categories are N1 divided by N, N2 divided by N, N3 divided by N and N4 divided by N respectively. The illustration will clarify the points. Number of boys and girls in various courses of social work. First column says about the serial numbers. Second tells about details of course. Third column is for boys and fourth is for girls. Certificate course in social work, there are 75 boys and 60 girls. Bachelor in social work course, 160 boys, 110 girls. Master in social work, 82 boys and 56 girls. Total number of boys, 317, and total number of girls is 226. The proportion of CSW students among boys is 75 divided by 317 or 0.236. The comparable figure for girls is 60 divided by 226 or 0.265. Other proportion can be computed in a similar fashion and results summarized in tabular form in table 2.
Proportion of boys and girls in various courses. In the table we can see that CSW students, boys proportion is 0.236, girls proportion is 0.265. In BSW course, the boys proportion is 0.505 and girls proportion is 0.487. In MSW course, boys proportion is 0.259 and girls proportion is 0.248. The total 100 boys, the proportion total is 1.
The value of a proportion cannot be greater than 1. Thus, if we add the proportions of cases in all categories, the result is 1. This is an important property of proportions. Percentage. The word percent means per 100. Hence, percentages can be obtained from proportion by simply multiplying by 100. In other words, percentage is the rate per 100. The figures in table 3 could just as well be expressed in terms of percentage as follows.
Table 3, number, proportion and percentage of boys and girls in various courses of social work. Course CSW, number of student boys 75, the proportion is 0.236 and the percentage is 23.6. For girls, the number is 60, proportion is 0.265, percentage is 26.5. For BSW course, there are 160 boys, their proportion is 0.505 and percentage is 50.5. And the girls' number is 110, proportion is 0.487 and percentage is 48.7. In MSW course, there are 82 boys whose proportion is 0.259, percentage is 25.9. The girls in MSW course number is 56, proportion 0.248 and percentage 24.8. Total number of boys 317, proportion is 1, percentage is 100. Total number of girls 226, total proportion is 1 and percentage is 100. How we have obtained 0.236 proportion for boys? Just to clarify it, we have divided 75 by 317, the total number of boys, we get 0.236. Similarly, the percentage is 75.317 into 100, we get 23.66%. Conventionally, percentages are calculated up to the nearest decimal and adjustments are made in the last digits, so the total are exactly 100. Ratios. The ratio of one number A to another number B is defined as the numerical quantity obtained by dividing A by B. Suppose that there are 800 male students and 300 female students in MSW classes, then the ratio of male students to female student is 800 divided by 300. In calculating ratio, the key term is the word to. Whatever quantity precedes the word is placed in the numerator, while the quantity following it becomes the denominator. In practice, a ratio is either reduced to its simplest form by cancelling common factors or is expressed in terms of a denominator of 1. Thus, the ratio of male students to female students would be written as 8:3 or 2.6621. For use of proportions and percentages, following rules of thumb are important. 1. Total number of cases should be always reported along with proportion or percentages. 2. Percentages must not be computed unless the number of cases on which the percentage is based is in the neighborhood of 50 or more. And percentages may be computed in either directions, and careful attention should be given to each table to determine exactly how each percentage has been obtained. Measures of central tendency. It is often essential to represent a set of data by means of a single number, which is in its way it's descriptive of the entire set. Obviously, the figure which is used to represent a whole series should neither have the lowest value in the series nor the highest value, but a value somewhere between these two limits, possibly in the center. Such figures are called measures of typicality or central tendency, or simply average. There are three important measures of central tendency used in social work: the mean or arithmetic mean, the median, and the mode. Arithmetic mean. The arithmetic mean is by far the most common of all the averages. It is relatively easy to calculate, simple to understand, and is widely used in social work research. The arithmetic mean is defined as the sum of the values of all the items and dividing the total by number of items. An example will help us to learn how to calculate the arithmetic mean. Let us suppose that 8 students receive 54, 58, 60, 62, 70, 72, 75, and 77 marks respectively in an examination. The mean of marks will be mean equals to 54 plus 58 plus 60 plus 62 plus 70 plus 72 plus 75 plus 77 divided by 8 equals to 528 divided by 8 equals to 66. The procedure in calculating mean can be expressed in algebraic form by the following formula: x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 plus xn divided by n, where x1, x2, x3, x4, xn are the item values and represents number of items. The above formula can be made more compact by assigning the arithmetic mean the symbol x bar, which is read as x bar, and using the notation sigma x, which stands for the sum of x's, that is sigma x equals to x1, x2, x3, x4 plus xn. Then we can write now arithmetic mean, that is x bar, equals to summation of x divided by n. Calculating the mean from ungrouped data. The above formula can be used to calculate arithmetic mean from ungrouped data. The following table gives the daily earnings of 15 rag pickers. The first column depicts the serial number of rag pickers. We have 15 rag pickers in the problem. Second column gives just the names of the rag pickers. And the third column, the total number of rag pickers n equals to 15 and summation of x, that is the total earning, is 258. Solution. If daily earnings of rag picker is represented by x, then sigma x is equals to 258. We have x bar equals to sigma x divided by n equals to 258 divided by 15 equals to 17.2. Hence, mean daily earnings equals to 17.2 or rupees 17.20.
Shortcut method. This method is based on an important property of the mean, that is, the algebraic sum of the deviations of the various item values from their mean is always equals to zero. Conversely, sum of the deviations of the various item values from some arbitrary value other than the arithmetic mean will not be equal to zero. This property can be illustrated from the following example.
The procedure of getting arithmetic mean has been presented in this table. The first column shows serial numbers of the items. The total number of items is 5. The values are 6, 7, 9, 11, 12. X bar or mean is calculated by sum total of the values of x divided by number of x items. That is 45 by 5 equals to 9. Deviation from x bar is now 9. Now we calculate the deviations of each value from this value 9. That is, you can see 6 minus 9 equals to minus 3. 7 minus 9 equals to minus 2. 9 minus 9 equals to 0. 11 minus 9 equals to 2. 12 minus 9 equals to 3. Or summation of the deviation is 0. Deviation d dash from 4, an arbitrary value. 6 minus 4 equals to 2. 7 minus 4 equals to 3. 9 minus 4 equals to 5. 11 minus 4 equals to 7. 12 minus 4 equals to 8. Summation of d dash equals to 25. Symbolically, arithmetic mean by shortcut method is x bar equals to a plus summation of d dash divided by n. A is the assumed arithmetic mean, d dash is the sum of deviation from the assumed mean, n is the number of item values.
If we compute mean daily earnings of rag pickers from the data given in the earlier example, table 4, by this shortcut method, it will give us exactly the same answer obtained by direct method. It is illustrated in table 6.
Again, the values of 15 rag pickers have been presented in table 6. First column gives the serial number, second, name of the rag pickers, third, daily earnings, fourth, deviation from an assumed mean, that is 20, as d dash. Here, we take the deviations from an arbitrary mean or assumed mean, that's 20. That means 14 minus 20 minus 6. Again, 14 minus 20 is minus 6. 15 minus 20 minus 5. 20 minus 20, 0. 12 minus 20 minus 8. 16 minus 20 minus 4. 17 minus 20 minus 3. 21 minus 20 plus 1. 22 minus 20 plus 2. 18 minus 20 minus 2. 20 minus 20 is 0. 13 minus 20 minus 7. Summation of d dash is minus 42. Arithmetic mean equals to x bar equals to a plus summation of deviations divided by n. Putting the values 20 plus 42 by 15 or equals to 20 minus 2.8 equals to 17.2.
Summary. Mean, median and mode are the three measures of central tendencies. Mean is the arithmetic average of a distribution. It is obtained by dividing the sum of all values of observation by the total number of values. Median is a point in an array above and below which one half of the values of measures fall. If the values are ungrouped and their number is small, the values are arranged in order of magnitude and the middle value is determined by counting up half, the value of n. When the number of value is odd, the mid value is the median. When the number of value is even, the median is the midpoint between the two middle values. Mode is the most frequently occurring values in a distribution. In a simple ungrouped series of measures or values, the crude mode is that single measure or value which occurs most frequently.